بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله الأحد القهار، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Indeed, all praise and thanks belongs to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala alone. We seek His help, His assistance and guidance in all things. He whom Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala guides, there is none that can misguide Him. And He whom Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala leads astray, there is none that can guide Him except through the will and permission of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala alone. And I bear witness and testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib al-Hashimi al-Qurashi was the final messenger and prophet sent to all of mankind. O you who believe, fear Allah. Fear Allah as He deserves to be feared. And do not die except in a state of Islam. Do not die except that you are Muslims. رَبِّ شْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَأَحْلُ الْعُقْدَةً مِّن لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. When I was studying in the Islamic University of Al-Madinah, we had a teacher who was one of my favorites, and he was in the earlier stages of my studies. And his name was Sheikh Abdul Rahman Al-Ahmadi, someone who no one knows, who is just a resident of Al-Madinah, and he was one of our sheikhs. But he taught us a subject, and that subject became, all of our class, it became our favorite subject. And what separated him from every other teacher was that he made part of the curriculum that every single week we had to read a book. We had to complete a book from a prescribed book list that he created. And every book on this list had one theme, one subject, which was the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Some books 30 pages, some 50, some over 100, 200 pages, but we had to read it in that week. Now, one of the books that stood out to me in this list was a book that was written over 500 years ago by one of the great scholars of hadith, Imam al-Suyuti rahimahullah. And he wrote a book which was called Miftahul Jannah, the key to Jannah, the key to paradise. Bil ihtijaj bis sunnah. Fil ihtijaj bis sunnah. Through what? Using the sunnah as evidence. Now, the book itself was a book that wasn't too long, and it goes through various topics regarding the sunnah, that the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was revealed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it was revelation, and that it was divine revelation itself, and that it is obligatory to follow the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam above all other statements, and that the sunnah was preserved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and many other topics. But I don't want to go into the actual book itself, I want to just focus on the name. The concept that the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the key to paradise, the key to Jannah. Now, when we're talking about the sunnah, it's a term that's thrown around quite often. But what does the sunnah actually mean? Now, when we go to the definitions of the word sunnah, it is befitting to go to Ahlul Hadith, the people of Hadith, and how they define this term. Now, in the Desi, in the subcontinent, it's Ahlul Hadith, right? But in Arabic, it's actually Ahlul Hadith, the people of Hadith, the congregation on Hadith. Now, what does Sunnah actually mean? And the definition that was given by Ahlul Hadith was a complete definition. And it was مَا أُثِرَ عَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Anything that was attributed to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم مِنْ قَوْلٍ, from his statements, أو فِعْلٍ, or from his actions, أو تَقْرِيرٍ, from his tacit approvals, أو صِفَةٍ خَلْقِيَّ أو خُلُقِيَّ, from his physical description, or his mannerisms and etiquette, أو سِيرَتِهِ, or his biography. Now, this is what is meant by the word sunnah. All of this that we just mentioned, this is what comes under the word sunnah. So in all of this, my brothers and sisters, is the key to paradise, the key to Jannah. Now one can ask, why didn't I say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the key to Jannah? Why didn't I say the Quran is the key to Jannah? Why didn't I say At-Tawheed is the key to Jannah? Because did An-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam call on to anything but that? If one follows Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will be upon Tawheed. He will be a follower of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he will be a follower of the Quran. So by default, the one who follows Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is going to do all of these things. So that is why Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the key to Jannah. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is this. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he decreed till the end of time that the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the only way to achieve obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah An-Nisa verse 80, مَن يُطِعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. And whoever obeys the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then indeed he has obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whoever obeys Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in reality Allah is saying that he has obeyed who? Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse is telling us that you cannot enter Jannah except through the obedience of Allah, and the obedience of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is just that. Now this authority is given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam specifically. No one else in the Quran is mentioned in this way, that if you follow him, you're following Allah. This is something unique to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he is telling us, if you really want to follow Allah, then you have to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he decreed that for all time, till the end of humanity, that following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the only way that you are able to express your love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you say you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the only true way to express that love. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Ali Imran verse 31, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ. Say, if you truly love Allah, if you truly love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, then follow me, follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah will love you. Allah will love you if you do what? Follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. And he will forgive you your sins. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set this in motion for all humanity, that you can't just say we love Allah and leave it at that, with no actual way of proving that love. You can't just say, it's not a blanket statement. Your love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shown through your obedience of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the way that you can show you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the only way. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, if you truly love Allah, then follow me, follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, the following of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what gets you the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يُحِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Allah will love you if you follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Can anyone enter Jannah without the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is it possible that Allah hates a person and can enter him into his garden? It's impossible. It's not possible. So this is the key to Jannah, my brothers and sisters. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He decreed till the end of time that simply by harming the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a person will be cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهِ. Indeed, those who harm Allah and harm the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهِ, Allah curses them. فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ, in this world and the hereafter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَأَعَدَّ لَهُمْ عَذَابًا مُهِينًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for them a painful punishment. Now over here, my brothers and sisters, this is the curse of Allah for simply harming Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Simply harming him earns you the curse of Allah. It would be enough if you were cursed in this world. Now that would be enough. يعني curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, خلاص, your life is finished. But imagine being cursed in this life and the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next life for simply harming the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The sunnah, my brothers and sisters, is the key to Jannah, is the key to paradise. Now we know, يعني sometimes this is silly when anyone says this on a stage or anyone says this in a talk, but we all know the first pillar of Islam, right? The Shahada. The testimony of faith. And no one can enter Islam except through this testimony. Now if someone came up to you and said, I am ready to embrace Islam today. And someone came up to him and said, Ashhadu. And then for some reason they always do the microphone. Like some, we have to hear the Sheikh saying it as well. I don't know why. But anyways, Ashhadu. Ashhadu. And like, I don't know why it happens like that. Just let the brother do it. Let the sister do it. Khalas. But anyways, if someone just said, أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله, left it at that, walked out of the room, everyone's happy, would anyone be happy at this? Would anyone say دخل في الإسلام هذا, this person has entered into Islam? No one will say that. It's impossible. Why? It's because it is composed of two things. The testimony of faith has two components. It is the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. Now if someone said ashhadu an la ilaha illallah and didn't have any concept of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did not believe in him, not from close, not from far, his Islam is not there to begin with. He hasn't come with the first pillar of Islam. This person is still a kafir. Is anyone, there's no ifs and whats or maybes about this. This is just common sense. Now, we all say Muhammad Rasulullah, we all say Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. But this testimony, it has conditions. It's not just something you can just walk around saying Muhammad Rasulullah, Muhammad Rasulullah, and you have nothing else under it, no substance behind it. This has actual conditions that you can say, if I do 1, 2, 3, and 4, then I truly believe that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah. A lot of people don't know this. A lot of people just say, khalas, just say Muhammad Rasulullah, and that's the end of it. But the conditions of the shahada for the testimony of faith in the belief of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are mentioned by the scholars, and they are four things. The first is that you have to obey the command of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If someone does not deem what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he came with, if someone does not think that they have to follow this, even if he's a sinner, right? But the concept is whatever Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam he brought, we have to obey it. This is the first thing. This is the first condition of Muhammad Rasulullah. Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has commands that you must obey. The second is you have to believe in that which he informed. You believe in that which Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave us. From that of the unseen and that which is seen. You believe that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever he came with was complete truth. This is the second. The third is avoiding that which he warned against. Whatever Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to abstain from, we abstain from it. No questions asked. Is it maybe, should I? No, no. Whatever he told us to stay away from, we stay away from it. That is the third. And the fourth is to not worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala except through the ways that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam legislated. Don't do any form of worship except through how Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did it. Now when you testify, Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, Muhammad Rasulullah, this is what you actually mean. This is what this statement actually means. Now, this is what the key to Jannah looks like. If you wanted to see what does this actual key looks like, it's these four things. Now, this is the only way you can enter Jannah, my brothers and sisters. The only way. And if you do not use this key, this Jannah, this key to Jannah, if you don't use it, then you will be of those who enter where the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. And there's no doubt about this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in Surah An-Nisa, verse 42. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَوْمَئِذِي يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَعَصَوُوا الرَّسُولِ. On the day those who disbelieved, and equally those who transgressed and disobeyed the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they will wish something. On the Day of Judgment, those who disbelieved and those who disobeyed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are going to wish something. Now, my brothers and sisters, right? What did they wish for? Yeah, this would be one of the most important things in their lives. This is the point of regret here. They will wish on the Day of Judgment, لَوْ تُسَوَّى بِهِمُ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا يَكْتُمُونَ اللَّهَ حَدِيثًا. They will wish that they would be reduced to dust, nothing, non-existence. On the Day of Judgment, they want to be brought to nothing. For what reason? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they disbelieved and they didn't follow the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they will only want one thing. They will only wish for one thing. And you have to take this one statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and contextualize it. You have to think about why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mention this? Because this is what happens when you don't follow the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day that Jahannam will actually be brought forward in front of the people. This is what Qiyamah looks like. Jahannam will actually be brought forward. Everyone will see it. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions that when Jahannam itself will be brought forward, it will be brought forward with 70,000 chains. And on every chain will be 70,000 angels. So I did the math. 4.9 billion angels dragging Jahannam. 4.9 billion angels. One of the most magnificent creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dragging Jahannam, the beast, the fire, roaring. And you can see it on that day. And when they see it, Jahannam, they know that that's where they're going to be now. Khalas, they disbelieve. They didn't follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So instead of that, I don't want to be anything. I'd rather be non-existent at this point, because if I have to go there, that's not where I want to be. So they will wish to be non-existent, that they would be reduced to dust instead of having to deal with that. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us, Ya Rabb. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He documents the horrific ramifications of anyone who does not follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Meticulously, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes what happens to these people. What will they be like on the Day of Judgment? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in Surah Al-Furqan, verse 27, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says,
وَيَوْمَ يَعُضُّ الظَّالِمُ عَلَىٰ يَدَيْهِ يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِ اتَّخَذْتُ مَعَ الرَّسُولِ سَبِيلًا.
On the Day of Judgment, On the day of judgment, when the transgressor, the one who disobeyed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the one who is destined for the hellfire, he will then bite on his hands. He will bite on his hands because he knows this is what caused him to be in this state. He is considered a zalim, a transgressor, someone who is going to be in the hellfire. Now, this transgressor, the one who is going to be in the hellfire, will bite both of his hands, which shows that he only blames himself for getting himself in this mess. He is in complete agony, complete anxiety at this point. And when someone is going to Jahannam and the realization sets in, this will be their greatest regret. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala documents for us what the greatest regret will be. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, at that moment when the realization sets in of where they're going to have to stay for the rest of their lives, oh how we wish, this is what they will wish. Oh how we wish that we had taken a path with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We wish we followed his methodology. We wish we took a path with him, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. That is what they'll be wishing for on that day, while biting on their own hands, blaming themselves for what they screwed up. Now, that, my brothers and sisters, is the danger of not taking this key, this road to paradise. Now, subhanallah, as we mentioned, the only way that we are to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam legislated as worship. How he worshipped Allah, we worship Allah. Now, there is, subhanallah, such a risk of anyone who doing any action that is not in line with the prophetic method. There is a risk involved. And subhanallah, the first risk is that the action that you do is going to be rejected. If you do any action that's not in line with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khalas, there's no fa'idah in it. It's rejected. Yani Aisha, as-siddiqa bint as-siddiq, the truthful, the daughter of the truthful, Umm al-Mu'mineen, the mother of believers, the wife of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, says in the famous hadith, it's found in Sahih Muslim, authentic, she says that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa rad. Whoever performs any single action, any single thing that's not in accordance to our way, the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our methodology, our teachings, then this action will be rejected. This action will be rejected. I'm not saying this, this is in Sahih Muslim. It's Qawl al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever does amalan, a single action, that is not in line with the methodology of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and that action is going to be rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, my brothers and sisters, if you try to find a way that is not from the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are only one thing, and I mean this with the utmost respect, you are an idiot. If you try to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way other than the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are only one thing. You are an idiot. And I mean this with respect. I'm not actually trying to make a mockery of you, but yani, this is the peak of stupidity. Wallah, billah, tallah. This is the peak of stupidity. That you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way other than the way of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, you try to find a way, you make yourself an authority to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not worship Allah, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not worship Allah through. This is the peak of stupidity. Why? Is because you do all of this effort. You do all of this effort to do something for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You try so hard, you do the action, and Allah rejects it. Peak of stupidity. And when it means rejected, it means zero. For that action, nothing. For that action, rejected. Zero. It's not like, oh, you get like good reward, good effort, you know what I mean? No. Rejected. Finished. Now, this is why Ahlul Sunnah, we are so passionate in trying to free you from the shackles of stupidity. to free you from the shackles of innovations in this religion, to free you from the shackles of bid'ah, deviation, innovations. And this is why we keep coming back to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam being the key to Jannah. Now, my brothers and sisters, one of the scariest things that can happen to a person on the Day of Judgment, it happens to those who innovated. It doesn't happen to everybody. It only happens to those who innovated. And this is from the scariest things that can happen on Qiyamah for that person. This is one of the scariest things. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to not make us from them, Ya Rab. But it is for the person who worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way other than what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam legislated. Now, I know you guys are getting tired, but who knows what the hawd of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is? Anyone want to have cracks at it? Hawd. No? Alright, next. Yalla, hawd. Hawd al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I can't hear. That's one opinion, but tell me, what is it? What is it? Okay. The hold of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a river. A river. Some people say pond, some people say bastion, but it's a river. It's a body of water. Now, this is where Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will meet us. This is where we will be seeing Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for the first time. Now, it is of the earliest stages of Qiyamah. And the hawd of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a massive body of water. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that its distance in length is the distance of a month in travel, and its width is a month in travel. Huge body of water. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that the number of cups in this river, in this body of water, are like the stars in the sky. No shortage of cups on that day. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says that the water in it is sweeter than honey, whiter than milk. Sweeter than honey, whiter than milk. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, whoever drinks from this hawd, from this water, will never experience thirst again. This is what? Before these massive things happen in Qiyamah, this is the one thing that you want. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who is giving you the drink. He's going to see you. Salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from them, Ya Rab. But there will be a people who are trying to come to this water. They are trying to come to this hawd of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to this river. And imagine all your life, right? We would die, we would sacrifice every inch of our lives to see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a lahza, for a moment. For a single moment, if someone said, give me 100 grand today and you'll see Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in your dream today, he will take out riba for that loan. Right? He'll do anything for it. He'll do anything for it. Why? It's because we have this great love for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yani we've been dreaming all our lives for us to be able to see Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, he is in front of you. But angels are pushing these people back. Angels will be pushing these people from getting to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be in front of the angels saying, Ya Rab, my Lord, Ummati, Ummati, my nation, my people, these are from me. These are my people. You promised me that they would be with me. You promised me, Ya Allah, Ummati, Ummati, my people. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will hear a response. He will hear the response. Why angels who don't do accept that which they ordered, this command is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why is this the case? إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُ بَعْدَكَ. You do not know what they invented. What they invented after you. In another narration, مَا بَدَّلُوا بَعْدَكَ. What they changed after you. مَا غَيَّرُوا بَعْدَكَ. In another narration, what they invented, what they introduced, what they changed. All of these things was the reason why the angels were pushing these people back. Now, what happens to رَحْمَةٌ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has the most rahmah of creation for everyone here. He is the mercy to all of mankind. right? The mercy to all mankind. He will see these people, he will understand why they're being pushed away, and then he will say something to them. He will say simply, suhqan suhqa. Be away from me, get away from me, I want nothing to do with you. You have been dying to see this man all of your lives, trying to implement every sunnah of his. Imagine on that day when you know that he is in front of you and he is disgusted by you. He is saying, suhqan suhqa, be away, get away, I want nothing to do with you. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his protection, Ya Rabb. Now, when it comes to those who innovated in their religion, whether in their creed or their actions, this is, subhanallah, the essence of innovation in bid'ah, in three words, what these narrations say. Inventing, introducing things in this religion, changing things in this religion, replacing things in this religion. But subhanallah, this is the response of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to those who did not follow his way. Now, my brothers and sisters, imagine this is your Prophet salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent him as a mercy to you. And so when we say the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the key to Jannah, this is the only key to Jannah. There's no other way that you can find another methodology to follow. No, no, no. This is the only key to Jannah. The sunnah of the Prophet salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the last verse. I know you guys are tired. It's getting late now. Yani, I've overstayed my welcome coming in from Sydney. Khalas, it's too cold here. You guys want to go home now? I forgot how cold Melbourne was. Wallahi, Sheikh, I genuinely forgot. I didn't bring a jacket with me. I drove in yesterday and it was freezing. I was like, what's wrong with these people? Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says,
وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ وَحَسُنَ أُولَئِكَ رَفِيقًا.
And whoever obeys Allah and obeys the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those will be the ones with whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed favor upon them from the prophets, the truthful, the martyrs, the righteous, and how excellent they are as companions. This is what happens when you follow Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through following Muhammad salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. And when one follows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by obeying Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he has achieved this key to the Jannah. And that is why the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the only key to Jannah. Barakallahu feekum wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man sanna bi sunnatihi ila yawm al-deen. I want to thank the brothers for inviting me up here. Wallahi, it was beautiful to see all of you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect and preserve all of you. Whatever you can do to help this masjid get off its feet, help. Because this, at the end of the day, it's not for a family, it's not for just one people, it's not for like just the desis over here or anything like that. No, it's وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ. And know that the masajid are for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is يعني, for Allah. You are establishing a house of Allah on the land. And for this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't leave you high and dry. No, no, no. You get something for it. It's almost selfish for you. If you do this, it's actually selfish for you. It's good for you. You're doing it for yourself. It's not for this masjid. It's for yourself. Because whoever builds a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will build for him a house in Jannah. Now imagine if Allah built something, do you imagine, can it be possible that this house would be shabby, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't make it properly? Wal'iyadu billah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his protection. This is a house created by the one who created the heavens and the earth. Look at the perfection around you, right? From the heavens and the earth. Allah created that. So imagine he creates something just for someone who created a house for him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Eight o'clock, Sheikh.